Greetings, family.
Peace,
greetings.
My brother. Peace.
Peace, how are you?
All right, this is Brother Amud in Florida.
Yo, what up, man? We just talked about
you. What's up, brother? You're right. I heard you clicking in there. Hey, listen, I got a question. I got a question for you, and it pertains to something that you were just speaking on when you were talking about writing the books. That's where my question comes from. We got a few parts, but I know you're going to answer this just the way I need you to. The question is, before you decide to teach the people, did you study teaching? How many different styles of teaching did you study? Which one did you choose, and how does it relate to the way you do your dissertations and write the books?
Well, you could definitely
wow.
tell this is one of those quick answers.
You didn't hear the last.
I think that we shutting it down tonight. I can answer that question too. As far as teaching, first and foremost, I never was thinking I was going to teach. I thought I was going to kind of have one foot in the streets and one foot in consciousness and buy me a book on the side. And whenever people start smoking weed, though I didn't. I was always the type to have a Heineken in my hand in front like I was smoking it, drinking the Heineken, but I had water in my shit. Like, I never wanted to drink, and I never wanted to smoke. So I would have the weed in the hand, and I would take it as if I was pulling it, but I made sure I purposely didn't know how to smoke it the right way, because they would say, nah, you got to inhale it. Like, we don't see you coughing out front, the cough and everything, but I never really was into the smoking or drinking at all. But the thing was, point being, I always kind of wanted to have what I thought was a form of having your ear to the streets, which is also a marketing term, to just make sure you're aware of everything that's going on. I always wanted to have one foot in the streets and one foot in consciousness. So I was just going to classes back and forth when I was going to Bushwick and, you know, Dr. York School of Thought. And one day, sister put me up and said, I'm not the only one that can teach, he could teach. Because, you know, I'd be in the cypher when class is over. And that lit me up.
Right.
That was on September 19th, 2002. I'll never forget. So that was an important day in my life. So I taught, and I wasn't happy with what I did. I was scared as hell. I thought I was a gangster. And when she put me up to teach, I almost cried in front of those people, man. I still got the tape. It's a VHS tape. So I looked at me. I didn't like the shape of my head. I was like, everything was just crazy. I'm like, yo, what the hell? You know, I was looking scared. My voice was shaking. And I said, yo, this is some deep stuff. Like, I'd be out here on these streets banging hard. And then I get asked to teach, and I'm scared. I could barely raise my voice. People like, come on, brother. Come on, take your time, take your time. I felt like such a little girl, man. I couldn't explain it. So I didn't like nothing. I didn't like how I walked. I didn't like how I talked. I didn't like how I looked. I was like, yo, this whole thing is horrible. And then I went up the next week because my Leo ego, you know, I'm like, I got to go do this again. But people said I did good, but I felt like it was giving me sympathy. But they said, yo, you did good. You did good, brother. That was good, brother. You know, they wanted me to do it because they knew I was still, you know, gangbanging and everything. That's why I, like, having my teardrops and on my eye and all that other craziness was going on. And my front, I had fangs in my mouth, you know, so people was just looking at me like, you know, some people was like, why the hell did you put him up? And then others was like, they was happy to see me up there, you know. And that was my inspiration. And in time, I was blessed to be able to talk to Dr. York on the phone. He heard about me doing pretty good in the store teaching, and he gave me advice. He told me to study my favorite comedian. And I told him I didn't even like comedy. He's like, yo, you got to like it. He said, big part of teaching has to do with entertainment, okay? And he said, if you can use satire, that's why you want to study comedians, because if you can use satire, you can make people laugh about real situations. The correspondence between the joke, the emotion that struck, the stimulus from the emotion of the laugh, and the actual knowledge that corresponds with it, it'll help people best be able to assimilate the information to be more coherent for them. So what happens is, he told me that he liked Richard Pryor and Eddie Murphy. That's who he studied. And he said, study it and get back at me. So I studied Dave Chappelle. I started rocking out and studying Dave Chappelle. And I was like, yo, that guy made me laugh, man. And he said, you can't study Chappelle without studying his mentor. So you got to study Paul Moore. So you got to get an idea of his teacher. And what part is his personality? So you understand you got to have your own personality. Because Dave Chappelle has his own personality, so much so, it almost looks like he wasn't influenced by Paul Mooney, okay? But then if you study the two of them, you can see the influence. So I started studying comedy because that's what my teacher told me to study. Then he said, now study me since you look up to me, but turn the volume down. You studied the tapes already, turn the volume down, and watch how I gesticulate. He said a big part of captivating your audience is being able to gesticulate in ways that you can connect with the audience that corresponds with the vibrancy and the frequency of the information that you're disseminating. So I'm like, damn, I didn't know what's all this stuff, man. I'm like, I just studied Dave Chappelle. I'm studying Paul Moody. I'm watching everything that they have. I'm looking for everything. And I wasn't even that internet savvy then. And, you know, YouTube really just came around about, like, 2005, you know. So that stuff wasn't really going on. So I had to really, like, buy tapes. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm buying tapes. And I'm just learning how to get computer savvy probably in 06 or 07. Right? I was afraid to type www. I thought it was going to blow the computer up or something. I was afraid. So I was still buying tapes and written shit from the library. You know what I'm saying? So I studied Dave Chappelle. I studied Paul Mooney, as he told me. I turned the volume down on Doc's VHS tapes, not even DVDs. They were still selling the VHS for a lot, most part. And I saw how he was moving. And I could almost, after a while, because I studied the tapes so much, you know how Doc is, I could almost pick up on what he was teaching sometimes, just by the way he was moving his arms. So then I was like, wow. So then he told me, don't limit yourself. Now what I want you to do is study the people that you don't give no credence to, that you don't even want to take the time out to listen to. Take the time out and study them and find something that they do that is good. Find it. So I studied a lot of people I just didn't want to listen to. And then he told me, try to join as much as organizations as possible that won't get you locked up. And if they will, try to stay on a level where you won't be getting locked up. Just study them sitting there. He said, I sat through many different schools of thoughts. So I sat in many Moorish meetings. I sat in the doggone groups. It was two doggone groups that I sat in. Okay? So I sat in two doggone groups. I joined like three Moorish communities. And I sat in for like two other Moorish communities. And I was just studying. I joined the lodge. Okay? I joined the lodge outside New Apple. Then I wound up getting into the Nuwapian Lodge, and then, you know, of course, I wanted to become a Deputy Grand Master jurisdiction from Canada down to the Mason-Dixon line. I started going in, and eventually I had a full perspective, and that's what he told me, the reason why he told me to join all those different schools of thought. And so this time my ear would really be to the streets. I really would have a full spectrum of information. So when I come across people, I'm never left out of conversation, all right? So he told me I had the mind for it before I even thought I did. And it was a long path. This is years of developing, studying comedians, turning the volume down, watching him, joining other groups, studying other people and turning the volume down, watching them, and then turning it back on and watching them, and realizing the best teachers are the people that were the most persuasive or influential. They knew how to use satire. And then the people that's just the wackest as hell, they don't know how to raise their voice in right intervals. Their hands don't connect with what they're saying. They're trying to do the hand movement, but it just looks fake. And it's like, you know, it just looks fake. It looks fake. They're not in tune with what they're saying. Their hand moves off beat to what they're saying. And it's not something you can really, get down logically, in a sense. It's kind of, like, natural. But after a while, when you are conscious of it, like I learned, like, he told me, make sure you teach class, you find the person that looks the most cynical, and you try to exert your energy towards them, because you'll teach better if you feel like you're under pressure, if you really want to be a teacher, you know. And so I try to find the pessimists in there. And if I see them with that funny look or that funny face, I try to convert them. And he said, but you never want to convert the pessimist or the one that's super critical of you. Not so much that you want to put your energy into that, because most of those people just walk away with the intent, you know, to not be satisfied. He said, what you want to do is use them to bring the best out of you, because people like conflict. But before the conflict come to you, teach as though that person is in conflict with you, because you'll go harder. And people wouldn't even see the conflict, but you'll be speaking in a way as though there's conflict, minus the conflict, and people could appreciate it. And then you'll be ready. And then he told me, go on the streets now and set up and teach on the streets. And he said, because that's raw. That's a different group of people. He said, those people, they got time to waste. He said, people just be walking, and they see you teaching other people, and they just stop, and they want to interrupt you and save the people from you. He said, people don't have no time. And sure enough, he was telling the truth. I'm on the streets, and people feel like they're the Messiah if they stop me from teaching other people. But the whole day, they came out the house, they had no intent on teaching no one anything. But then they come, and they interrupt what I'm saying. And, you know, it took growing, because before, I was pissed off. But then what it started making me do, I started going home, committing stuff to memory, He said you got to treat it like boxing. You got to go in there and build yourself. That's if you're serious about this. He said everybody isn't serious. If you're serious about your craft, you're going to find yourself committing certain key things to memory so you can make sure you can prove to people on the spot, write it down on a piece of paper, tell them go home, check it out, because he said people are so into this ignorance thing, you got to damn near recite a whole book and write it out in front of people and tell them they want you to hold their hand and babysit them. But if you're serious, you'd be willing to do it for some or most, understanding that there's a potential chance that you might change their life or have an effect on their life. So the combination, I'm walking you through the whole thing Doc put me through. The combination, and I got letters where he tell me, go to the mosque and ask the Muslim this. Go to the Hebrew Israelites and ask them this, literally. And he said, if you don't give me an answer, I'm assuming that you know, and I stop holding your hand. And this is my master teacher. So I went there. I still got the letters. You'll see it in my Father's Keeper book. I think that's tome number 60. That advice that he gave me was really based on somebody wanting me to become better, because he didn't have to give me none of that. And I'm sharing it with people on the phone. He didn't have to give me none of that. But he gave me that because he said he seen something in me. And he said I remind him of himself. He said, I remind him of himself. And he said, I was born, sent, and raised to resurrect our people. He wrote that for my birthday to my wife and a birthday card from prison. All right? So I've been talking to him on the phone. After a while, not that I tried to be Dave Chappelle, and I have my own personality, of course, and that was the purpose of studying his mentor, so I can make a distinction between the two, so I never lose myself in the personality of the person that I look up to, namely Dr. Young. So, but after a while, for someone like me who didn't like comedy, after a while, I wound up having it in me because that's what I'm exposing myself to. That's what I'm watching all the time. And if I ain't doing that, then I'm watching people's hand movement. And he said, don't worry about trying to get it right. Your subconscious mind will put it into play, and one day it'll just be natural. Make sure you don't look at one side of the room too often. Make sure you walk around. If you watch other lecturers and you watch me, one of the main reasons why people stay awake when I teach is because my voice goes up and down at critical moments and because I walk around when I'm teaching. It's two things that you don't see a lot of people do. Now, some people...
Right.
How to read, like Phil is good. Phil reads for hours. I don't agree with that shit. That'd be driving me crazy. Phil Valentine would read for like 8 hours. But when he reads, he'd be like, and you know, at least that keeps you up, because at some point he gonna scream again. You know what I'm saying? So Phil got that part good, because he'd be reading for hours, man. But at least he does that. You know, and then you got Eileen Bay. He's very intelligent. But Eileen Bay, he talked real low, you know. So when he went against Seti, I think most people felt that he lost because his spirit just ain't, you know, it just ain't rocking out with the way Seti's spirit was and conveying his message. But he got undermined his message because of the way he was conveying it. But I'm not trying to criticize him in a bad way. That's his right to teach the way he wants to teach. I don't want people to take that and do something negative with it. I don't want him to do something negative with it. But I'm saying... different people and studying different people and seeing what works for people, what doesn't. I learned from my teacher, yo, he be walking left and right. He never stays still when he teach. And, you know, some people are not comfortable. They got to stay still. And he taught me to work out certain areas of my body so I could stand up for 6-7 hours at a time. Because he said it'll catch up with you after 2-3 years. He said your body won't be able to accommodate for the weight. And he said bad enough that you're not on earth. You want cement or you want hard floor, so whenever you walk, your organs shake, and it's not healthy for you. So he said you have to be able to accommodate for the shaking of your organs as you walk in against a surface that's in conflict with your motion. He taught me mad stuff, so I wound up doing lower back exercise and everything. So my lower back is, like, built crazy, you know, and also, of course, triceps and everything to make sure I could hold the mic when I have to hold the mic. But it's a lot of conditioning behind it. Then writing the books, that's a whole other concept. We probably have to save that for the next show. I'm trying to give it all, you know what I'm saying? But these are the things
right.
You know, I do, but I everything from conditioning your body to stand for long hours, drinking maple syrup, maybe for my throat, so I don't go hoarse, because I teach a lot. I don't teach, and then I go into hiding for 4 months. You know how I be, between the radios alone, and then teaching class and traveling back and forth, and then you just know I'm a talker in general. I wouldn't be able to have the voice that I have. Then I talk on the streets with no microphone, and I'm out there teaching on the streets, trying to talk above fire engines and police cars. And a lot of people really don't understand the work ethic that I put and how I eat. I have to eat a certain way so I don't grow fatigue when I'm writing books for long periods of time, because I have to get off the phone and write books or video edit. I get off the phone, and I'm writing books straight after. I could play basketball like I did last night with the brothers in Indiana, and the second I came in the house, I went and started editing video, and I started working on lessons. So, and then I have to do, I was out here handling business and doing mail orders and all sorts of stuff, trying to work things out to get 2-3 new people intact for the mailing system and try to get a new system going. And then dealing with the printers failing and then getting them back up and all this other stuff. Dealing with all that, and then I come in. I try to lay down for 20 minutes, but here we go. I got to get back on the show. But I'm conditioned because I make sure I eat a certain way. I don't eat after certain hours. I make sure I'm drinking certain waters. I'm drinking my syrup. I'm having my cayenne pepper and everything that I eat and everything that I drink. Take my bitter cola. That diffuses any potential cancer, and it helps out my lungs. I'm a number one frequency, so the most susceptible disease or ailment that I'll have will go straight to my lungs because I'm a number one frequency. Secondly, I'm an orator, which most number ones are. And orators, okay, or speakers, they're always susceptible to lung problems because of the amount of air that goes through their body when they're speaking. So because I speak so much, I make sure I eat in such a way and I exercise in such a way because I'm standing, and that I take certain herbs so I can have the longevity or so I can diffuse fatigue because I have to stay up long hours upstairs. You know, I sleep every other day. So moving around like this, it takes a lot. And then I'm driving when the brothers ain't with me. You know, the Dominican brothers that you know do the road assistance and everything, the road managers,
right.
They ain't out with me for California trip. They on a vacate. So I'm literally taking the bulk of the hours and my wife Anuka to drive from the East Coast all the way to the West Coast. Then from the West Coast, we drove to Indiana. Then tomorrow, we're going into Chicago. Then from there, we're going to go to New York after 2 or 3 days. So, and then I got Philly September 30th. So, and then after that, Chicago October 6th. And then after that, I'm back into New York. And then after New York, October 14th, I'm going to California again, October 21st. Then after that, the following week, October 28th, I come back over here to help Brother Simon out for the Astro All Crazy event and do the catering, because people that know me know I like to cook food. And a lot of the food that gets cooked for the event, I also participate in cooking. And I cook the food during the day of the events. People don't even realize. I'll be finishing the book in the morning sometimes. It's getting pressed. I'm cooking food. And then I got the PowerPoint ready. But it takes a lot of conditioning. And like Doc said, ultimately, if you want to be great, you got to be willing to lose sleep and even abstain from sex. So even though I got 3 wives, a lot of people probably think we getting our freak on. We doing all sorts of craziness. But little do they know, niggas is backed up in here sometimes. And I get the pressure. You know what I'm saying? Because we're working hard. We're working around the clock. But when you know how to transmute the energy, if you could transmute sexual energy, it turns into creativity. And you wind up being able to produce a whole lot. You know, so he also had taught us a great deal about that, how to abstain from sex and use that energy, because it's creative energy, it creates children. So if you learn how to transmute that energy, it turns into productivity. So I learned a whole lot, bro. It's a lot. I guess we could pick up the book thing. For the next show, if you could let us know or send a text like, yo, let's get it in. We could start off maybe the next show about leadership or something like that. Could that be cool too?
Let's do it. Let's do it. You know, because I've been speaking to when I speak to the brothers about new covenant, different information and whatnot, you know, and they ask me different questions. They always seem to tell me that the way I articulate the information, I break it down pretty good into layman's terms so that they can swallow it a little better. So, you know,
yeah,
I'm doing my due diligence and I'm following
you. Sound like you want to write a book, man. What's going on there?
Hey, man, you know it's coming, man. You know it's coming, you know. But I feel like the book comes before the title. So, I feel like the book comes before the title. So I'm going to put the work in. I'm going to keep putting the work in. And we're going to keep working together.
Especially as far as the status correction is concerned. I remember you blew my mind away. If you remember my face. He's going in. This is definitely flawed. This caseworker right here. Tell me, what's the likeliness of you chopping out for the proficiency exam? I never got the chance to chop it up with you. I sent you a text or an email. I don't know if you got it. I told you something crazy was going on family-wise.
Right. Yeah, and I sent an email. Referring to that.
Matter of fact, I remember your email. Yeah, I did see the email.
Right.
It was forces just to distract me from getting that event off and doing what we had to do. Plus, I had a tight schedule to travel. I never drove from east to west like that. So I say, you know what? I know what it is. And that's another part of this thing, man. You got to know when forces, six ethers coming after you in an endeavor to diffuse your potential growth, success, and cultivation for the most part. So that's another thing people have to evaluate. When you start seeing weird things happening at choice times, you got to see it for what it is instead of be overwhelmed by it and be mad that it's happening. You got to tell them, I think all of this is designed to defer my attention from that which I'm supposed to be doing. And it took a while to mature on a level where I don't completely just lose it, because it always happens when you got so much pressure. You're dealing with pressure. When I say pressure, I used to have lectures, and I'm giving a dude my money to keep my lights on. This is when I first started. Dude ain't been paying the light for 5-6 months. I need the light on so I can type. I need the light on so I can pray. The little bit of books I used to print before we was doing this thing bigger. And in 3 days, this is 3-4 days before the lecture, my joint, my lights is out, and I'm only on page 36. I'm like, yo, and people will not let me in their house for whatever reason. I'm like, what the hell? You know, I'm trying to find people. You know, I don't deal with my fam like that. And then people are like, nah, I'm a baby mama, you feel me? Yo, I'm like, yo, this is crazy. This book is not going to come out. And I take failing real hard. So I stayed in Starbucks, and I stayed in Kinko's in New York, in the city in Manhattan, and typed it out. Just did what I had to do. And I had to refrain from busting that Negro's behind. That was the catch 22. To find out he wasn't paying the light for 6 months straight. 6 months I've been giving him money. Six.
Wow.
And my bread wasn't tight like that. Because I put my bread into my future. This is what I wanted to do. And I was just getting off the ground. And I just had my first good show March 20th when I started. You know what I'm saying? Like, I remember the dates. I got to remember the dates. I'm a numerologist. So March 20th when I just started. This is how it went down on me, man. And I was like, yo, I could pay all this money 6 months back light. But I'm like, this is supposed to be for my new printers, and I have to pay for the venue. I had to decide if I have to cancel the event, I got to give the guy the rest of the deposit. And I said, I worked around it. And you know what? The ancestors blessed me. Somebody came in that event. I don't know what it was that I taught that was so good, but that person gave me a $3,000 donation.
Wow.
Donation, 3 stacks. And that was just what I needed to get that light back on, and then it never slowed me down from what I had to do. So bad things happen, but I always get those signs, man. Always. And this is a true story. Because I had relocated my family to a crazy man crib just for 3-4 days. And my family would tell you that he's crazy. They're laughing. This is a real story. This Negro is
right.
Nuts. He drives on the wrong side of the street. He almost hits crossing guards. They jumping out the way like cartoons. This is an actual fact. Yo. But as crazy, and he farts, he belches obnoxiously. But when you come to his house, he's a neat freak. He takes his shoes off, his stinky feet. He farts, he belches. He drives on the wrong side of the street. He almost hits people with a car. You go to his house. He has nothing but beautiful pictures of leaders. Doc is up there. He has lamps. His crib is almost like a shrine, and it's in the projects, but his crib is the most peaceful project apartment I've ever been in. I thought I was going to be in hell for those days. His house, he wants your shoes off. He don't want you leaving stuff all over the place. I'm like, this guy, he's one of those people when he stands up, you can see the crack of his ass, and you don't want to see him. He's one of those people whose belly is always hanging over his belt. But you go to his house, and he's a neat freak. I said, yo, this guy is crazy. That's when I realized he was crazy. That's when I realized. But we stayed over there for 3-4 days. And I wound up with that donation. I just said, you know what? I don't want to quit this. I'm going to do this event, and I'm going to see what happens. You know, and I'm dealing with pressure. Like, please tell me we're not staying over here. Like, I'm like, no, we're going to go back. I'm going to pay it. But, and this was when I was in my inception. I said, look at this. If I did it the wrong way, which wouldn't have been wrong, if I had just canceled the event and I would have paid for the light and then had nothing right after that, for all I know, I may not be in this direction today. For all I know, I had to go with the wind and do what my heart told me to do, which was to teach.
Greetings, family.
Peace,
greetings.
My brother. Peace.
Peace, how are you?
All right, this is Brother Amud in Florida.
Yo, what
oh,
up, man? We just talked about
it. What's up, brother? You're right. I heard you clicking in there. Hey, listen, I got a question. I got a question for you, and it pertains to something that you were just speaking on when you were talking about writing the books. That's where my question comes from. We got a few parts, but I know you're going to answer this just where I need you to. The question is, before you decide to teach the people, did you study teaching? How many different styles of teaching did you study? Which one did you choose, and how does it relate to the way you do your dissertations and write the books?
Well, you could definitely tell this is one of those quick answers.
You think you can handle that?
We're shutting it down tonight. I can ask that question too. As far as teaching, first and foremost, I never was thinking I was going to teach. I thought I was going to kind of have one foot in the streets and one foot in consciousness and buy me a book on the side. And whenever people start smoking weed, though I didn't. I was always the type to have a Heineken in my hand in front like I was smoking it, drinking the Heineken, but I had water in my shit. Like, I never wanted to drink, and I never wanted to smoke. So I would have the weed in the hand, and I would take it as if I was pulling it, but I made sure I purposely didn't know how to smoke it the right way, because they would say, nah, you got to inhale it. Like, we don't see you coughing out front, the cough and everything, but I never really was into the smoking or drinking at all. But the thing was, point being, I always kind of wanted to have what I thought was a form of having your ear to the streets, which is also a marketing term to just make sure you're aware of everything that's going on. I always wanted to have one foot in the streets and one foot in consciousness. So I was just going to classes back and forth when I was going to Bushwick and, you know, Dr. York School of Thought. And one day, sister put me up and said, I'm not the only one that can teach. He could teach. Because, you know, I'd be in the cypher when class is over. And that lit me up.
Right.
That was on September 19th, 2002. I'll never forget. So that was an important day in my life. So I taught, and I wasn't happy with what I did. I was scared as hell. I thought I was a gangster. And when she put me up to teach, I almost cried in front of those people, man. I still got the tape. It's a VHS tape. So I looked at me. I didn't like the shape of my head. I was like, everything was just crazy. I'm like, yo, what the hell? You know, I was looking scared. My voice was shaking. And I said, yo, this is some deep stuff. Like, I'd be out here on these streets banging hard. And then I get asked to teach, and I'm scared. I could barely raise my voice. People were like, come on, brother. Come on, take your time, take your time. I felt like such a little girl, man. I couldn't explain it. So I didn't like nothing. I didn't like how I walked. I didn't like how I talked. I didn't like how I looked. I was like, yo, this whole thing is horrible. And then I went up the next week because my Leo ego, you know, I'm like, I got to go do this again. But people said I did good, but I felt like it was giving me sympathy. But they said, yo, you did good. You did good, brother. That was good, brother. You know, they wanted me to do it because they knew I was still, you know, gangbanging and everything. That's why I like having my teardrops and on my eye and all that other craziness was going on. And my front, I had fangs in my mouth, you know, so people was just looking at me like, you know, some people was like, why the hell did you put him up? And then others was like, they was happy to see me up there, you know, and that was my inspiration. And in time, I was blessed to be able to talk to Dr. York on the phone. He heard about me doing pretty good in the store teaching, and he gave me advice. He told me to study my favorite comedian, and I told him I didn't even like comedy. He's like, yo, you got to like it. He said, big part of teaching has to do with entertainment, okay? And he said, if you can use satire, that's why you want to study comedians, because if you can use satire, you can make people laugh about real situations. The correspondence between the joke, the emotion that struck, the stimulus from the emotion of the laugh, and the actual knowledge that corresponds with it, it'll help people best be able to assimilate the information to be more coherent for them. So what happens is, he told me that he liked Richard Pryor and Eddie Murphy. That's who he studied. And he said, study it and get back at me. So I studied Dave Chappelle. I started rocking out and studying Dave Chappelle. And I was like, yo, that guy made me laugh, man. And he said, you can't study Chappelle without studying his mentor. So you got to study Paul Moore. So you got to get an idea of his teacher. And what part is his personality? So you understand you got to have your own personality. Because Dave Chappelle has his own personality, so much so, it almost looks like he wasn't influenced by Paul Mooney, okay? But then if you study the two of them, you can see the influence. So I started studying comedy because that's what my teacher told me to study. Then he said, now study me since you look up to me, but turn the volume down. You studied the tapes already, turn the volume down, and watch how I gesticulate. He said a big part of captivating your audience is being able to gesticulate in ways that you can connect with the audience that corresponds with the vibrancy and the frequency of the information that you're disseminating. So I'm like, damn, I didn't know what's all this stuff, man. I'm like, I just studied Dave Chappelle. I'm studying Paul Mooney. I'm watching everything that they have. I'm looking for everything. And I wasn't even that internet savvy then. And, you know, YouTube really just came around about, like, 2005, you know. So that stuff wasn't really going on. So I had to really, like, buy tapes. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm buying tapes. And I'm just learning how to get computer savvy probably in 06 or 07. Right? I was afraid to type www. I thought it was going to blow the computer up or something. I was afraid. So I was still buying tapes and written shit from the library. You know what I'm saying? So I studied Dave Chappelle. I studied Paul Mooney, as he told me. I turned the volume down on Doc's VHS tapes, not even DVDs. They were still selling the VHS for a lot, most part. And I saw how he was moving. And I could almost, after a while, because I studied the tapes so much, you know how Doc is, I could almost pick up on what he was teaching sometimes, just by the way he was moving his arms. So then I was like, wow. So then he told me, don't limit yourself. Now what I want you to do is study the people that you don't give no credence to, that you don't even want to take the time out to listen to. Take the time out and study them and find something that they do that is good. Find it. So I studied a lot of people I just didn't want to listen to. And then he told me, try to join as much as organizations as possible that won't get you locked up. And if they will, try to stay on a level where you won't be getting locked up. Just study them sitting there. He said, I sat through many different schools of thoughts. So I sat in many Moorish meetings. I sat in the doggone groups. It was two doggone groups that I sat in. Okay? So I sat in two doggone groups. I joined like three Moorish communities. And I sat in for like two other Moorish communities. And I was just studying. I joined the lodge. Okay? I joined the lodge outside Nuapo. Then I wound up getting into the Nuapian Lodge, and then, you know, of course, I wanted to become a deputy grand master jurisdiction from Canada down to the Mason-Dixon line. I started going in, and eventually I had a full perspective, and that's what he told me, the reason why he told me to join all those different schools of thought. And so this time my ear would really be to the streets. I really would have a full spectrum of information. So when I come across people, I'm never left out of conversation, all right? So he told me I had the mind for it before I even thought I did. And it was a long path. This is years of developing, studying comedians, turning the volume down, watching him, joining other groups, studying other people and turning the volume down, watching them, and then turning it back on and watching them, and realizing the best teachers are the people that were the most persuasive or influential. They knew how to use satire. And then the people that's just the wackest as hell, they don't know how to raise their voice in right intervals. Their hands don't connect with what they're saying. They're trying to do the hand movement, which it just looks fake. And it's like, you know, it just looks fake. It looks fake. They're not in tune with what they're saying. Their hand moves off beat to what they're saying. And it's not something you can really, get down logically, in a sense. It's kind of, like, natural. But after a while, when you are conscious of it, like I learned, like he told me, make sure you teach class, you find the person that looks the most cynical, and you try to exert your energy towards them, because you'll teach better if you feel like you're under pressure, if you really want to be a teacher, you know. And so I try to find the pessimists in there. And if I see them with that funny look or that funny face, I try to convert them. And he said, but you never want to convert the pessimist or the one that's super critical of you. Not so much that you want to put your energy into that, because most of those people just walk away with the intent, you know, to not be satisfied. He said, what you want to do is use them to bring the best out of you, because people like conflict. But before the conflict come to you, teach as though that person is in conflict with you, because you'll go harder. And people wouldn't even see the conflict, but you'll be speaking in a way as though there's conflict, minus the conflict, and people could appreciate it. And then you'll be ready. And then he told me, go on the streets now and set up and teach on the streets. And he said, because that's raw. That's a different group of people. He said, those people, they got time to waste. He said, people just be walking, and they see you teaching other people, and they just stop, and they want to interrupt you and save the people from you. He said, people don't have no time. And sure enough, he was telling the truth. I'm on the streets, and people feel like they're the Messiah if they stop me from teaching other people. But the whole day, they came out the house, they had no intent on teaching no one anything. But then they come, and they interrupt what I'm saying. And, you know, it took growing, because before, I was pissed off. But then what it started making me do, I started going home, committing stuff to memory. He said, you got to treat it like boxing. You got to go in there and build yourself. That's if you're serious about this. He said, everybody isn't serious. If you're serious about your craft, you're going to find yourself committing certain key things to memory, so you can make sure you can prove to people on the spot, write it down on a piece of paper, tell them go home, check it out, because he said people are so into this ignorance thing, you got to damn near recite a whole book and write it out in front of people and tell them, they want you to hold their hand and babysit them. But if you're serious, you'd be willing to do it for some or most, understanding that there's a potential chance that you might change their life or have an effect on their life. So the combination, I'm walking you through the whole thing Doc put me through. The combination, and I got letters where he tell me, go to the mosque and ask the Muslim this. Go to the Hebrew Israelites and ask them this, literally. And he said, if you don't give me an answer, I'm assuming that you know, and I stop holding your hand. And this is my master teacher. So I went there. I still got the letters. You'll see it in my Father's Keeper book. I think that's tome number 60. That advice that he gave me was really based on somebody wanting me to become better, because he didn't have to give me none of that. And I'm sharing it with people on the phone. He didn't have to give me none of that. But he gave me that because he said he seen something in me. And he said, I remind him of himself. He said, I remind him of himself. And he said, I was born, sent, and raised to resurrect our people. He wrote that for my birthday to my wife and a birthday card from prison. All right, so I've been talking to him on the phone. After a while, not that I tried to be Dave Chappelle, and I have my own personality, of course, and that was the purpose of studying his mentor, so I can make a distinction between the two, so I never lose myself in the personality of the person that I look up to, namely Dr. Young. So, but after a while, for someone like me who didn't like comedy, after a while, I wound up having it in me because that's what I'm exposing myself to. That's what I'm watching all the time. And if I ain't doing that, then I'm watching people's hand movement. And he said, don't worry about trying to get it right. Your subconscious mind will put it into play, and one day it'll just be natural. Make sure you don't look at one side of the room too often. Make sure you walk around. If you watch other lecturers and you watch me, one of the main reasons why people stay awake when I teach is because my voice goes up and down at critical moments and because I walk around when I'm teaching. It's two things that you don't see a lot of people do. Now, some people try to read, like Phil is good. Phil reads for hours. I don't agree with that shit. That'd be driving me crazy. Phil Valentine would read for like 8 hours. But when he reads, he'd be like, and, you know, at least that keeps you up, because at some point he's going to scream again. You know what I'm saying? So Phil got that part good, because he'd be reading for hours, man. But at least he does that. You know, and then you got Eileen Bay. He's very intelligent. But Eileen Bay, he talked real low. You know, so when he went against SETI, I think most people felt that he lost because his spirit just ain't, you know, it just ain't rocking out with the way SETI's spirit was and conveying his message. But he got undermined his message because of the way he was conveying it. But I'm not trying to criticize him in a bad way. That's his right to teach the way he wants to teach. I don't want people to take that and do something negative with it. I don't want him to do something negative with it. But I'm saying different people and studying different people and seeing what works for people, what doesn't. I learned from my teacher, yo, he be walking left and he never stays still when he teach. And, you know, some people are not comfortable. They got to stay still. And he taught me to work out certain areas of my body so I could stand up for 6-7 hours at a time. Because he said it'll catch up with you after 2-3 years. He said your body won't be able to accommodate for the weight. And he said bad enough that you're not on earth, you on cement or you on hard floor. So whenever you walk, your organs shake and it's not healthy for you. So he said you have to be able to accommodate for the shaking of your organs as you walk in against a surface that's in conflict with your motion. He taught me mad stuff. So I wound up doing lower back exercise and everything. So my lower back is, like, built crazy, you know, and also, of course, triceps and everything to make sure I could hold the mic when I have to hold the mic. But it's a lot of conditioning behind it. Then writing the books, that's a whole other concept. We probably have to save that for the next show. I'm trying to give it all, you know what I'm saying? But these are the things you know, I do, but I everything from conditioning your body to stand for long hours, drinking maple syrup, great beef for my throat, so I don't go hoarse because I teach a lot. I don't teach, and then I go into hiding for 4 months. You know how I be between the radios alone and then teaching class and traveling back and forth, and then you just know I'm a talker in general. I wouldn't be able to have the voice that I have. Then I talk on the streets with no microphone, and I'm out there teaching on the streets, trying to talk above fire engines and police cars. And a lot of people really don't understand the work ethic that I put and how I eat. I have to eat a certain way so I don't grow fatigue when I'm writing books for long periods of time, because I have to get off the phone and write books or video edit. I get off the phone and I'm writing books straight after. I could play basketball like I did last night with the brothers in Indiana. And the second I came in the house, I went and started editing video. And I started working on lessons. So, and then I have to do, I was out here handling business and doing mail orders and all sorts of stuff, trying to work things out to get 2-3 new people intact for the mailing system and try to get a new system going. And then dealing with the printers failing and then getting them back up and all this other stuff. Dealing with all that, and then I come in. I try to lay down for 20 minutes, but here we go. I got to get back on the show. But I'm conditioned because I make sure I eat a certain way. I don't eat after certain hours. I make sure I'm drinking certain waters. I'm drinking my syrup. I'm having my cayenne pepper and everything that I eat and everything that I drink. Take my bitter cola. That diffuses any potential cancer, and it helps out my lungs. I'm a number one frequency, so the most susceptible disease or ailment that I'll have will go straight to my lungs because I'm a number one frequency. Secondly, I'm an orator, which most number ones are. And orators, okay, or speakers, they're always susceptible to lung problems because of the amount of air that goes through their body when they're speaking. So because I speak so much, I make sure I eat in such a way and I exercise in such a way because I'm standing and that I take certain herbs so I can have the longevity or so I can diffuse fatigue because I have to stay up long hours upstairs. You're not sleep every other day. So moving around like this, it takes a lot. And then I'm driving when the brothers ain't with me. You know, the Dominican brothers that you know do the road assistance and everything, the road managers,
right.
They ain't out with me for California trip. They on a vacay. So I'm literally taking the bulk of the hours and my wife and new cat to drive from the East Coast all the way to the West Coast. Then from the West Coast, we drove to Indiana. Then tomorrow, we're going into Chicago. Then from there, we're going to go to New York after 2 or 3 days. So, and then I got Philly September 30th. So, and then after that, Chicago October 6th. And then after that, I'm back into New York. And then after New York, October 14th, I'm going to California again, October 21st. Then after that, the following week, October 28th, I come back over here to help Brother Simon out for the Astro All Crazy event and do the catering because people that know me know I like to cook food. And a lot of the food that gets cooked for the event, I also participate in cooking. And I cook the food during the day of the events. People don't even realize. I mean, finishing the book in the morning sometimes. It's getting pressed. I'm cooking food. And then I got the PowerPoint ready. But it takes a lot of conditioning. And like Doc said, ultimately, if you want to be great, you got to be willing to lose sleep and even abstain from sex. So even though I got 3 wives, a lot of people probably think we getting our freak on, we doing all sorts of craziness. But little do they know, niggas is backed up in here sometimes. And I get the pressure, you know what I'm saying, because we working hard. We working around the clock. But when you know how to transmute the energy, if you could transmute sexual energy, it turns into creativity. And you wind up being able to produce a whole lot, you know. So he also had taught us a great deal about that, how to abstain from sex and use that energy, because it's creative energy, creates children. So if you learn how to transmute that energy, it turns into productivity. So I learned a whole lot, bro. It's a lot. I guess we could pick up the book thing for the next show if you could let us know or send a text like, yo, let's get it in. We could start off maybe the next show about leadership or something like that. Could that be cool, too?
Let's do it. Let's do it. You know, because I've been speaking to when I speak to the brothers about New Covenant and different information and whatnot, you know, and they ask me different questions. They always seem to tell me that the way I articulate the information, I break it down pretty good into layman's terms so that they can swallow it a little better. So you know,
yeah,
I'm doing my due diligence and I'm following
your footsteps. It sounds like you want to write a book, man. What's going on there?
Hey, man, you know it's coming, man. You know it's coming. You know, but I feel like the book comes before the title. So, I feel like the book comes before the title, so I'm going to put the work in. I'm going to keep putting the work in, and we're going to keep working together.
Especially as far as the status correction is concerned. I remember you blew my mind away, if you remember my face, you was going in. This is definitely flawed. This caseworker right here. Tell me, what's the likeliness of you popping out for the proficiency exam? I never got the chance to chop it up with you. I sent you a text or an email. I don't know if you got it. I told you something crazy was going on family-wise.
Right. Yeah, and I sent an email. I sent an email referring to that.
Matter of fact, I remember your email. Yeah, I did see the email. Right. It was it was forces just to distract me from getting that event off and doing what we had to do. Plus, I had a tight schedule to travel. I never drove from east to west like that. So I said, you know what? I know what it is. And that's another part of this thing, man. You got to know when forces, six ethers coming after you in an endeavor to diffuse your potential growth, success, and cultivation for the most part. So that's another thing people have to evaluate. When you start seeing weird things happening at choice times, you got to see it for what it is instead of be overwhelmed by it and be mad that it's happening. You got to tell them, I think all of this is designed to defer my attention from that which I'm supposed to be doing. And it took a while to mature on a level where I don't completely just lose it, because it always happens when you got so much pressure. You're dealing with pressure. When I say pressure, I used to have lectures, and I'm giving a dude my money to keep my lights on. This is when I first started. Dude ain't been paying the light for 5-6 months. I need the light on so I can type. I need the light on so I can print the little bit of books I used to print before we was doing this thing bigger. And he, in 3 days, this is 3-4 days before the lecture, my joint, my lights is out, and I'm only on page 36. I'm like, yo, and people will not let me in their house for whatever reason. I'm like, what the hell? You know, I'm trying to find people. You know, I don't deal with fam like that. And then people are like, nah, I'm a baby mama, you feel me? Yo, I'm like, yo, this is crazy. This book is not going to come out. And I take failing real hard. So I stayed in Starbucks, and I stayed in Kinko's in New York, in the city in Manhattan, and typed it out. Just did what I had to do. And I had to refrain from busting that Nick Rose behind. That was the catch 22. To find out he wasn't paying the light for 6 months straight. 6 months I've been giving him money. Six.
Wow.
And my bread wasn't tight like that. Because I put my bread into my future. This is what I wanted to do. And I was just getting off the ground. And I just had my first good show March 20th when I started. You know what I'm saying? I remember the dates. I got to remember the dates. I'm a numerologist. So March 20th when I just started. This is how it went down on me, man. And I was like, yo, I could pay all this money 6 months back, right? But that was, I'm like, this is supposed to be for my new printers, and I have to pay for the venue. I had to decide if I have to cancel the event, I got to give the guy the rest of the deposit. And I said, I worked around it. And you know what? The ancestors blessed me. Somebody came in that event. I don't know what it was that I taught that was so good, but that person gave me a $3,000 donation.
Wow.
Donation, 3 stacks. And that was just what I needed to get that light back on, and then it never slowed me down from what I had to do. So bad things happen, but I always get those signs, man. Always. And this is a true story. Because I had relocated my family to a crazy man crib just for 3-4 days. And my family would tell you that he's crazy. They're laughing. This is a real story. This Negro is
right.
Nuts. He drives on the wrong side of the street. He almost hits crossing guards. They're jumping out the way like cartoons. This is an actual fact. Yo, but as crazy, and he farts, he belches obnoxiously. But when you come to his house, he's a neat freak. He, this guy, yo, it was, yo, he takes his shoes off, his stinky feet. He farts, he belches. He drives on the wrong side of the street. He almost hits people with a car. You go to his house. He has nothing but beautiful pictures of leaders. Doc is up there. He has lamps. His crib is almost like a shrine, and it's in the projects, but his crib is the most peaceful project apartment I've ever been in. I thought I was going to be in hell for those days. His house, he wants your shoes off. He don't want you leaving stuff all over the place. I'm like, this guy, he's one of those people when he stands up, you can see the crack of his ass, and you don't want to see him. He's one of those people whose belly is always hanging over his belt. But you go to his house, and he's a neat freak. I said, yo, this guy is crazy. That's when I realized he was crazy. That's when I realized. But we stayed over there for 3-4 days. And I wound up with that donation. I just said, you know what? I don't want to quit this. I'm going to do this event, and I'm going to see what